In early June this year, I pulled a dead and detached limb from a white pine tree in my yard and saw this perfectly round 9mm hole in it. Last year, I found such a hole in my potting bench of pressure-treated lumber and learned that it was the nest of a carpenter bee. I am an old biologist at heart and wanted to examine it more closely. As dead and dry as the branch was, I was surprised at what I found. First off, the bee was still inside and seemed in no hurry to come out. I was not aware that these bees sting very rarely, and I was being overly careful. In fact, I was afraid to let it out. You can hear it buzzing inside. The bee flew away before I could get a photograph, but I have every reason to believe it was an Eastern carpenter bee. I was surprised, but should not have been, to see how far the creature had tunneled within the branch. I cut away what I thought was excess wood with some pruning shears, only to find I had cut through a brood cell. Having already made a mess of it, I proceeded further. Near the center of this picture, you can see where I used my bandsaw to cut across the branch. As luck would have it, I cut right across the septum that divides two brood cells. Look what popped out of the distal one. This grub was alive and very active. When I accidentally cut across one of these with my saw, I found that they were just sacks of fluid, white creamy liquid, and I wondered where all the water came from. The cells contained residual granular material that I originally thought was sawdust, and small, dark, cylindrical objects that I assumed were frass, or fecal material, from the grubs. I suppose, in retrospect, it is possible that some of the powdery material was residual pollen. The female bees store pollen and nectar in the cells to provide nourishment for their developing grubs. On the proximal side of the cut, that nearest the hole, there was another grub, and he was quite active. I used my bandsaw again to try to divide the limb longitudinally, but I made a mess of it. Here are three pieces of the entire tunnel. On the left, you can see where I cut through with the shears, and on the right, where I cut with the bandsaw. There were 9 cells in this tunnel. Each was 20mm long from septum to septum and about 13mm in diameter. The developing larvae, or pupae, furthest from the hole were the best developed. The question in my mind is, how do these better developed larvae get out without plowing through their younger counterparts? I hope one of you experts out there clears this up for us. This is the entrance chamber beneath the hole. It was pretty clean without any evidence of having eggs laid in it or grub development. The bee creates the septums between the brood cells from tiny pieces of wood that it has chewed up. The insects in the cells furthest from the hole were the best developed. The head on this one is on the right, and you can see its mouth parts and its antenna. What will become its wings are becoming darker in color. In one cell, I could not identify a developing insect. I thought perhaps this lump represented a dried out and decayed larva that had died. In retrospect, I wonder if it might not have been the original wad of bee bread in a cell in which the egg had not hatched or survived. Again, perhaps one of you experts can comment. But if this was bee bread, it might give some indication of the volume originally placed in a cell by the female bee. I am sensitive to the fact that 8 or 9 carpenter bees were harmed in this non-professional examination. I am in awe of the amount of work that is accomplished by these industrious creatures. I hope you've learned something too.